you.
I made an entire rant video about this about halfway through the once we were done, I believe, fight number two. And because I, when I was reading it, I also agree with you. I think it's the best fight so far.
Remember, the real champions tournament is the only thing going on. There is technically the second annihilation tournament happening as well.
True.
Before, like, the Berserker Bowl, like, who was it? I forget his name now, bro. Sekabayashi. Yes, mm-hmm. Sekabayashi was saying, like, he wasn't going to participate in that tournament because most of the companies that, like, basically have, you know, these top tier fighters that we want are saying, hey, look, you're going to have to sit this one out because we need you for when the annihilation tournament happens,
yeah.
Right?
Pre-initiative isn't the answer to all your problems in the same sense that all these characters are only so under Shen because they already all thought they reached the top of the mountain, their pinnacle, their ceiling. It was reached. There was no higher heights to find. Now that they know there's a vast mountain range left to climb, everyone's improving in leaps and bounds because they know it exists now. They've seen it with their own eyes.
Griever, great to have you back on the channel. Today we're going to be discussing the real champions tournament. Let me start off with maybe having Griever greet the channel because, like, you've been here before. So, hey, I think considering how well the video did, I'm pretty sure a lot of people know who you are, at least if they're regular viewers. But hey, introduce yourself just for a little bit.
Yo. It's Griever, baby. I'm back here once again on Dio's channel. Thank you very much for the invite. I always love doing collaborations with fellow Kangen YouTubers. I believe that the video did do incredibly well last time. I'm excited to be a part of this one as well. I believe we were even called the Dragon and the Tiger. Dio being the dragon, I was the tiger, going together to talk Kangen, so in one of the comments. So yeah, excited to talk about this.
Yeah, that was a little bit of a weird comment. But hey, it's kind of cool as well. But let's just get right into it, right? Let's not waste too much time on the real champions tournament. What are your thoughts now that round one is done?
Well, I like the tournament thus far. It's a solid, I would say so far, 7 out of 10 for me, you know? And that's not a bad ranking whatsoever. That's above average. That's a pretty good. That's just... it's good. It's not amazing. It's not great. But so far, I've been liking it. There's been a few drops, and I see the complaints. The biggest complaint I've seen is, okay, we introduced new characters when we could have had familiar returning faces face off and stuff like that. And as someone who would have loved to see some returning faces in this tournament rather than the new characters, I can get behind that statement a little bit. But outside of that, no. I've been pretty okay with the setups, with the fights, and for the most part, yeah, it's been a pretty fun ride.
Well, let me just ask a clarifying question, I guess. Let's go with, so we've had, like, I think 3 tournaments, including this one in the series so far. Where would it rank on those generally?
Actually, that is a bit of a tough question. You'd think it'd be easy, but I think because we haven't seen the end of this tournament yet, I'm a little hesitant to rank it fully. I think so far I enjoyed the Berserker Bowl the best. As far as both the whole preliminary thing and leading into the main tournament. Then so far, if this one is going to be, if these next couple of fights, especially the finals, is going to be as good as I hope they're going to be, it is absolutely going to beat KVP out of the water. So I had a lot of problems, honestly, with KVP. Not as much as some people did, but I had quite a few problems with it as a tournament. It was way too long. So, but I know we're not here to talk about KVP, but yeah, it's just so right now, I think, assuming that these next few fights aren't total flops, I would say it would go so far for me, Berserker Bowl, then the real tournament, and then KVP as far as Omega goes.
Right. I guess giving my general thoughts. Going into this fight, this tournament, I think there were very high expectations considering its main thing is like it has the champions. You know, this is the big boy league, right? So you're expecting the best of the best to come out. And I think when you have that in perspective, I think, yeah, it is understandable that some people are disappointed, especially for like some of the newer characters. But we'll get to talk about that a little bit more. I do like the tournament overall. I'm also kind of waiting for like those semifinals and finals to happen. But I am liking it. It's had some of the, I think the best fight in this round one, just saying it now, I think is Jurado versus Gao Lang. At least for me, I think it's the best fight so far. Mm-hmm. But yeah, let's just start by talking about each of the fights one by one, talking about the stuff that we liked, didn't like, you know, the fight itself. Mm-hmm. And we'll start off with the one that I just mentioned, my favorite fight, and coincidentally the first fight in this round, and that is Gao Lang versus Jurado. Okay, how did you feel about this fight, Griever? Let's start with you.
I made an entire rant video about this about halfway through the once we were done, I believe, fight number two. And because I, when I was reading it, I also agree with you. I think it's the best fight so far, and it's a great fight. It's a solid 9 out of 10. Some of the art could have been a little better, sure, no, but overall, Gao Lang versus Jurado, it was perfect. Because as you said, for all the faults that the real tournament has failed on, one of them is not bringing both of the two kings of purgatory into this tournament, and another one is not bringing the best striker in the series into it. And we had a matchup between a guy who just beat Agito and the guy who only ever lost one time to Agito, and he just overcame him. And the whole setup at the end of that fight saying, you know, I'm here, I don't really give a crap about this tournament, I'm here literally for the chance of a rematch with you, the one man I've ever lost to, sort of idea. And Agito's like, bring it, man, I'm excited too, because you kicked my ass in boxing. Like, I lost the boxing match. So it's like, all right, let's go. They were setting up the narrative. It was nice. It was clean. And the fight itself, like, people had so many problems, in my opinion, that just, they didn't hold a lot of water. Because the Arashiyama's whole thing is swing. He touches you with just a fingernail and boom, you're on the ground. So this was always going to be a very cat and mouse, a very technical fight, a chess match. It was never going to be a slugfest. It was never going to be a very long. It was going to take one opportunity, just one chance, and boom, major damage. Whether God Glow hits or swing hits, somebody was taking major damage. This was only ever going to be that. And the fact that people expected it, I don't know what they expected, but it went exactly almost how I thought it was going to go. I was happy to see Gao Lang win because Gao Lang is one of my favorite characters. And I think he is underappreciated by the community and stuff for being as good of a fighter as he is. And this tournament's going to prove it. And as I said, the fight went at a good pace. The choreography could have been a little better here and there, the art or whatever, sure. But overall, I thought it was the best fight so far that we've seen in the tournament. I really liked it. Arashiyama was no slouch either. He did very well. It's just that Gao Lang has made up for his past mistakes and he's improved. And especially with the idea, this fight introduced something that was fantastic that so many people complain about in many other manga, which is if you don't have Super Saiyan, everybody else is left behind. If you don't have this type of chakra, everybody else is left behind. If you don't have God Ki, everyone else is left behind. You know, it doesn't matter. If you don't have Bankai, just take your series, and all of a sudden, the further the series goes, there's only one power system that matters. If you don't have Conqueror's Haki, if you don't have Bankai, if you don't have this... This literally said, yeah, pre-initiative, inception of intent, fantastic. But there are ways that people, you know, whether you have it or not, there are still fighters that are that goddamn good that can beat that. It's not an all-win, everyone with pre-initiative beats everyone that doesn't have it sort of idea. Kanade was doing this, but now we have an A-level fighter who's proving the same thing. I don't know why anybody would complain about that. That elevated the chapter to me to say, yeah, it's not just Kanade's way of being, I'm weak, so I need to figure out plans to beat the strong. If the strong people can also pull this tough. And it was great for the power scaling and the power system overall to say, yeah, pre-initiative is not the be-all and end-all. It doesn't determine the winner right off the bat without even, you know, the fight. So, yeah, round one, or fight one, fantastic for me. And I know you said it was your favorite, so what are your thoughts, my man?
Yeah, I guess we'll go into that part very soon. But I did want to talk about something else, of course, pertaining to this fight. Because I neglected to talk about the reason we're in the Real Champions Tournament, or how it got recontextualized around Shen Wulong. And it's going to definitely tie into the Gao Lang versus Jurado fight. I will tie it in there. Because... There is a very big issue right now with the verse, with the Kengen Association looking for someone to fight Shen Wulong, and that is that most of the fighters have sort of reached this ceiling. And we sort of see this with, let's say, someone like Jurado, who is basically a master that was similar to like Kuroki and had basically things like being able to sense the inception of intent and being able to just outright overcome Agito at some point. And now you have Gao Lang, who has, you know, in his own way, sort of caught up to that level as well. And it represents this, let's say, deadlock in the entire, you know, the fighters on the Kengen side right now. And that is something that I found very interesting in the fight between Jurado versus Gao Lang, that yes, Gao Lang doesn't have, you know, the general toolkits, or at least he didn't use the toolkits that you would expect him to use, like sensing the inception of intent. He's just using, you know, he's leaning more into his skill, and he's just so good at it that one of the biggest problems Jurado faced right off the bat is that he just couldn't do his advanced move. He even admits it during the fight. He's like, look, I can't really go into my bag that deeply, because he's a foresight killer. I can't use, you know, that part of, you know, my martial arts or how I actually fight. And I thought that was very interesting, because one thing we've noticed, and this is going to become a trend, the fighters in this tournament, they're very good at what they do. And best case scenario, I guess, you have a situation where you're fighting someone who is not doing the same type of martial arts you're doing, and now you're just trying to drag them into playing your game. And once they start playing your game, once you're in control, like, that's it, you're done, you know? And that's the thing that I saw with Jurado versus Gao Lang. It's that Gao Lang, for the most part in this match against Jurado, he's in control, kinda. Like, yeah, Jurado, he's a danger, right? Like, the positions could flip in a matter of a second, but Gao Lang, he's staying in control almost the entire fight, with a few slip-ups here and there, and basically that big, you know, IQ play that he does at the end. So... That I think
I would actually just to step into to that point, I would step in and say he controlled the whole fight. And what you said about slip ups, I wouldn't say they were exactly slip ups. It's just that you can't win a perfect chess match against another chess master. So he was gambling on, all right, I've got to take this shot. There is a chance it's going to end badly for me, but I have to take this shot, you know, this opening, as it were. And there wasn't a 100% guarantee of getting out that fight unscathed. But I do agree with you that he controlled the flow and the playing field of the match almost the entire time, at the very least.
Yeah, and that's something that I found very interesting, right? I guess I would say it was a mistake, at least not the end, you know, the final move, because Gao Lang did launch that God Glow, you know, on purpose so that he could counter Jurado's counter, right? It was just a matter of a guess at the end. What was interesting is that, like, there were times where Jurado definitely caught Gao Lang slipping in the fight. And I think... And I think when Gao Lang has basically taken out most of Jurado's toolkit, because remember, he already can't use his advanced techniques, and also include the fact that he's like a grappler fighting against an opponent that is just like basically moving incredibly fast, to the point where his best move is to like counter. Like, that's really all he can really do at that point.
Yeah.
So I think Jurata just ended up, it is a case of like, they were a bad matchup for one another, but I think Gao Lang was definitely doing better in the matchup perspective. Like he almost seemed like he had the better hand in that fight going into it. So that's what I could say for that.
I would agree with that, and I think it gets glossed over maybe because it was just in an off panel or whatever. But the fact that that a lot of people mistaken or a lot of people said, "Oh, pre-initiative," and I believe it was Yama even said about, it's not that Gao Lang doesn't have pre-initiative or can't use it; it's that he doesn't need to use it. And it actually is the worst thing possible because people who get pre-initiative end up relying on it as master level martial artists, and Gao Lang trips them up and stonewalls them, as you said, blocking out, unable to use all their power, all their advanced techniques, because they are used to be able to use this, and using it against Gao Lang, you're going to lose. Yeah. So you can't use it. So you have to turn it off. But now if you've been using it for years, you rely on it. And it's like, so Gao Lang's sort of a damned if you do, damned if you don't wild card situation. And that makes him incredibly versatile and incredibly powerful in that regard. And it gets glossed over because it was just that one panel. But it's like, oh, no, it's not that he's just a killer. He has pre-initiative. He just doesn't need to use it. And it trips up other people who already have it. So it's better for him to literally not use it. He's more powerful without it. And it's like, damn. That's pretty cool. Like I know it was just one throwaway panel in the fight, but it's like, that's important information to go going further for any other fights involving Gao Lang and anybody else who doesn't have pre-initiative, you know, that we know of. They might be able to pull off something similar, you know?
Well, yeah, I think it was actually Lo Long who was directly trying to point that out. And I think...
Oh, Lo Long, yes, it wasn't Yama. It was like, you're right, yes.
It was Lo Long. So I think it is actually to his benefits that Gao Lang does that. Because, like, think of it this way. He's probably going to be faster than his opponent majority of the time. Like, unless you're facing insane characters, right? Like, we're talking like you're fighting Shen Wulong or like, you know, Gilbert or something. Like, abnormal situations, Gao Lang's probably going to be faster than his opponent.
Yep.
And he's probably going to be a better striker as well. So, forcing his opponent into a guessing game is better for him. It just turns out to be the flat out better move. So Gao Lang, very, very dangerous in this tournament. Like that's something that is pretty established. And I think we did talk about this after we recorded our conversation on Shen Wulong, that we kind of did see the writing on the wall for Gao Lang winning against Jurata, which to me, I sort of wish I didn't see it coming, because it would have been the impact of that win would have hit me a lot more. I just couldn't see a scenario where Gao Lang loses two times in a row in fights that we've literally seen him in. I know the fight was good, but that to me is like, yeah, look, that's why I saw that coming.
Yeah, and the other issue is the thing that sealed it for me, as you said, after our first recording we did, the thing that sealed it for me was not that Gao Lang had lost against Medel, because everyone, even Waka and Oma and Agito, said, we all know who actually won that goddamn fight. You beat Medel at his own goddamn game. You are the king of boxing. No one's better than you. That we're being tripped up by the rules. You know what I mean? It's not your fault. You know, we'll make up for it. That wasn't what sealed it, that he had lost there. What had sealed it for me was just before the tournament, Jurata had beaten Agito. That's what told me Jurata's not going to beat Agito, then beat Gao Lang, then not fight against Agito again, you know, so Agito has to lose. Agito's not going to lose twice in a row. There was too many factors between Agito's record and Gao Lang's record that just added up to, as you said, by the time this fight started, the writing was on the wall, you know, and it just, narratively speaking, Sandra was not going to take two fan favorite characters and continuously make them lose. You know, it just wasn't going to happen. So,
yeah.
Yeah, no, I agree. But still, as you said, versatile. Galang, and Galang fans, which we know are very, very big in the community. I mean, they're eating really good right now.
They're eating so good, man. Like, it really is amazing to see. At least I'm happy for them, because, like, at the same time, man, like, the last time we saw Galang fight was against Medel, and you say, well, he won the fight. I say he lost. Look, dog, he got a ring out. It's his fault. I'm a bit more brutal in that sense. But the fact the fact that he got a dub against, like, again, Jurata, and it does sort of make Jurata's fight against Agito kind of necessary, because I can imagine if Jurata had come back now without fighting Agito and lost to Gao Lang, how bad that would have been for Jurata's character. That's the one thing I'm starting to think, like,
he needed
to be established as well. Like, there is the thing where the writing was on the wall, but the fact that if that fight between Jurata and Agito didn't happen, Jurata as a character, man, he would have been in the mud, bro. It would have been horrible.
True. But I wanna push back just a little bit on it, because I do agree. But I want to do a little bit of devil's advocate, push back a little bit on that one, because just like you said, you're a little more brutal and you're like, nope, Medel won that fight. Those are the rules. And I'm like, yeah, but as the Kangen guys go, listen, Gao Lang thought he was fighting almost a gentleman's duel. Like, Medel wouldn't do something so cheap to win the fight. Like, he thought, no, we're fighting as honor of boxers. He's too honorable. To be fair, it's a character flaw, but that makes him a three-dimensional character. But the same thing you could say about Arashiyama. Even Lo Long says, if he just kept swinging Misaki, he wins. He stopped using his judo because he was going to kill him. So his only fight on screen up until the Agito fight, which he did lose, but once again, he lost doing the rules of purgatory. Like, that's like saying Alan Wu defeated Ryan. Well, no, he did not. And ripped him in half. You know, so yeah, they both got disqualified, but that's my point, is that the KVP, the biggest problem with KVP is that people utilize these as here's the record without looking at the actual technical aspects. If you take all of the fights from KVP and plug them into the Ashura tournament, those results are way different for who wins, who loses, who's disqualified. We never would have gotten to Oma versus Lo Long. Right. Kangen Association would have won by about round 8. You know, they never would have had all 13 fights. It never would have happened. So that's my biggest deal with that, is using those fights it's a little subjective. That's all I'm saying. Like, once again, because had he kept throwing, Meguro's brother there, he would have killed him. And that's why he stopped throwing him, because he's like, shit, one more throw, he's really going to die. So he stopped throwing him. That really limits Jurata's big move, you know? So once again, his on-screen loss kind of has a little bit of connotation there, just like Medel versus Gao Lang, just like a few of them, Alan and Ryan and all this stuff. So as far as I'm concerned, it's like, yeah, as you said, you're more brutal. It's like, no, the records are the records, the rules are the rules, the facts are the facts. I appreciate that. I do. But as a sports fan of many sports, I always do look at sometimes the technical, well, if the refs got it wrong, you know, I mean, yeah, the record says this, but everyone in their hearts knows that guy caught the ball, that guy got the touchdown, that guy did this, you know what I mean? So, you know, I know it doesn't really matter after the fact, but I do think sometimes context does matter. And that's the problem, once again, with the power scaling when we go into these things. And that's why I think sometimes the matchups are interesting, because I really do think that Gao Lang, even though we both agree that we saw Gao Lang winning this fight, I do think that Arashiyama, Sandro could have pulled a fast one and had Arashiyama beat Agito and Gao Lang.
Yeah.
Like, I could have seen it. It could have happened, you know?
Yeah, it really did come down to the final moments when, Gao Lang launched the God Glow and Jurata countered that. And Gao Lang countered Jurata's counter. Which, here's something crazy about that moment. It sort of shows Gao Lang's growth, because he lost to Medel the exact same way. In fact, that's what was so interesting about Jurata's plan. I don't know if you noticed. In Kangen versus Purgatory, Gao Lang launches the God Glow And Medal, he uses like pre-initiative to read ahead, and he basically gets the ring out like that on Gao Lan. Yep. Gerarda's plan was similar. He was waiting for the God Glow, even though I don't think Medal was aware the God Glow even existed. He was still waiting for that strike and waiting to basically do the winning move from that point on. The fact that Gao Lan basically knew exactly what Gerarda was probably going to do and countered that, it just shows his development as well. I think that was a nice touch, at least for me, when it came to this fight as well. It just shows, like, look, Gao Lan, he's sort of grown as a character as well. So that was pretty nice to see.
I agree with you 100% on that. And I think that just proves that once again, Gao Lan is a seasoned veteran fighter. He's, you know, not just for the underground, but in public and stuff. And he knows, he showed his trump card to some of the best fighters in the world in KVP. They're all on the lookout for that move.
Yeah.
So he knows that God Glow looked dangerous to everyone. No different than Waka going, damn, I used Blast Core. Now Agito has seen it. The idea of keeping your trump card close to your chest is used by veteran fighters. Gao Lan and Waka being two very good examples of this. And it's just like, yeah. So he knows that a seasoned fighter is going to be like, I'm going to wait for the opening of that move. You know? So, I mean, yeah, I thought it was a really technical fight. It was a great fight. I've seen the complaints, but I don't understand them. I don't know, man. I like the fight.
Yeah, the only thing I've heard is that people say Gerarda was standing the entire time, but like that really wasn't the case. He was trying to grab Gao Lan at multiple points. He wasn't standing as much, but yeah, that's really about it. I really don't get it. Like I'm trying.
I want these guys to line up and take from the best boxer in the world, literally the best boxer in the world. I want them to stand there and say, oh yeah, but swing is just one touch. Yeah, while getting punched in the face by the best boxer in the world, I want you to try to touch him. Go ahead. While he's throwing 13 punches a second in your face, I want you to try to concentrate enough to grab a hold of his arm. You go right ahead. Tell me how that works out for you. You know what I mean? Like, so yeah, no, the whole idea. He was just standing there, blah, blah, blah. It's like, no, Gao Lan was aware of swing. He knew how dangerous it was, and he kept up the attacking momentum because being defensive, he would have got swung.
Yeah, like,
so
couldn't afford to be offensive at all.
No, he couldn't. It had to be all out offense. Otherwise, he was going to probably lose to Gerarda because his swing, that one swing he got off on Gao Lan did massive damage. They even stated it. And Gao Lan,
it didn't even complete. Like, he cushioned the blow. It was like,
yeah, he cushioned the blow, and Gao Lan still got up and went, God damn, that fucking hurt. You know what I mean? Like, once again, like, that's what I appreciate about this fight is that Gao Lan has never been known for his great durability or his endurance, and Gerarda has a lot of weight on him. His swing is dangerous to the point that, like, 5 was going to kill a man, you know, who weighed closer to him than Gao Lan does. So, I mean, like, seriously, the swing is nothing to sniff at. It's just that Gao Lan knew about it, was prepared for it, and fought in a way to work around it. It's simple as that. I don't get why people think that wasn't a good fight. I don't know, man. I loved it. It was a great fight.
Well, let's move on to the next one, because, oh boy. Now, I'm going to start off with this one. What's interesting about this fight, talking about Justin versus Sakigake, I noticed something very interesting, because I have polls for each chapter to gauge people's thoughts, and this one is the most low rated. I think every chapter of this fight is like, basically there are three categories to vote in. I have trash, mid, and goated. And
yes, I vote on them sometimes. Definitely, yeah. Everyone, go vote. Go vote on his community polls.
Yeah. Besides like the final chapter of the fight between Justin versus Sakigake, which most people, you know, kind of liked that chapter, every other chapter is mid. And yeah, it's a very interesting fight. Let me just say that. What do you think of it?
Okay. As like with the Gao Lan thing, I had a big rant about this one. I'll keep it incredibly brief by saying, if your complaint about this fight, if your complaint about anything involving this is that Mikitsuchi's not in this tournament, Oma's not in this tournament, Waka, Hatsumi, any of the other S-tier fighters, Ryan's not here, any of the other S-tier fighters that could actually hold a candle to Agito, Gao Lan, Julius, any of these guys, is not here. We get these new characters, and the fight was such a weird, like, one-hit KO, after a backstory thing. Okay, reasonable complaint. Because I agree. I don't know why Hatsumi's not in this tournament. I don't.
Well,
but
there is an in-universe reason, right? Because let me just...
Well, yeah, there is. It's just a very weak reason. It's weak. Well, it's in-universe reason, but...
There are two of them because, like, remember, the real champions tournament is the only thing going on. There is technically the second annihilation tournament happening as well.
True.
Before, like, the Berserker Bowl, like, who was it? I forget his name now, bro. Sekabayashi. Yes. Mm-hmm. Sekabayashi was saying, like, he wasn't going to participate in that tournament because... most of the companies that, like, basically have, you know, these top tier fighters that we want are saying, hey, look, you're gonna have to sit this one out because we need you for when the annihilation tournament happens, right? So you're not gonna see a heavy hitter like Wakatsuki when they're expecting, like, look, this, the Kengan annihilation tournament could be announced tomorrow. I need you in top shape. You know, that's
true.
What I'm guessing is happening with, you know.
And I do think another problem is that people took the real tournament to crown the best of the best of the champions. People took that a little too outside universe literally. What they mean is literally the one standing on top of each of the other underground, which that's what they represent, right? It's literally the current king of each of the different organizations. It doesn't mean literally we all think that Hatsumi is stronger than these three guys, so why isn't he here and stuff like that. So there is that as well. But as I said, once again, going back to the point, if that is your complaint, it's reasonable enough as far as I'm concerned. It's a reasonable complaint, but kind of get over it because, you know, like, you're gonna have to get over it. Like, unless you want to shit on the rest of the tournament, you got to get over that. We already know who the combatants were going to be the moment the tournament started. So it is what it is. As far as the fight goes, I know why people make fun of it. I don't have a problem with it. I just don't. Is it a great fight? No. But was Ren versus Setsuna a great fight? Was Mikazuchi versus Nemu a great fight? Was, you know, Ryan versus Allen a great fight? Was this a great fight? Like, we have had in the Ashura tournament, in KVP, and the Berserker Bowl, we had these fights that literally, whether due to bad matchup, power difference, Rahito versus Kuroki, anybody, we had fights. We've had this time and time again where people have literally just been, okay, this dude might be a good martial artist, but he is way out of his goddamn league, and he gets fucking no diffed. And that's what happened here. Justin took some hits, went, I can take a hit, you're not that strong, and when he gets one good hit on him, it's over. Clearly, Sakigaki there is, which I never liked, I don't like his design, I don't like his character, I don't like anything about him, is a twofold character. One, he was there basically to sort of, we're still trying to tie in the Niwa clan with the Star Strike at Rich manga and stuff, and I think they're laying that on really thick in this Omega, in the later Omega chapters, which I think is what's dragging it down a little bit.
Well,
but also, in general...
We also have, by the way, the Anti-Worm Alliance. I don't know why they're still around, but the Neo group is apparently part of that as well.
And that's a thing too. And he's sent here as an assassin and all these things, as an infiltrator, blah, 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 blah. You know, I mean, yeah, do I agree we shouldn't have gotten all this backstory for got one shot and then one shot again? No... I agree. Was that a waste of pages and ink? A little bit, but that was more to a call into the Anti-Worm Alliance, the Star Strike at Rich tie-ins, etc., etc. That's all that was there for. Honestly, I've seen fights like that before, but I didn't, you know, I just don't understand. Everybody wanted these super high-def fights for each fight, and I don't know. I'm glad that between two new characters, it was so quick. Because now we are setting up that Justin apparently has two trump card moves that he's going to use against Gao Lang, and we, the reader, still don't know what they are. And Gao Lang, you know, spoiler alert for the latest chapter, is already dominating that fight like everybody expects. I think these ace in the holes, while not going to win him the fight, might turn that around. So the fact that Justin won clean without showing off his blast core, his god glow, his what, devil lance, whatever his moves are, is a good thing for the current fight that we're on. in a roundabout type of way. So was it a setup fight? Was it a fodder fight? Sure, but it was short. It's only a couple weeks of chapters, boys. Like, and there were new characters. Why are you that upset? It's not like your fan favorite character got their shit kicked. So why are you so upset that two characters that no one had any stock in, that we just got introduced to, was only three chapters of a fight and was over? It just shows that Justin's awesome. Sakigaki sucks. Okay, move on to the next fight. You know what I mean? Like, as far as I'm concerned, got way too much hate for actually being, which in real sports and in the Ashura tournament and this whole time for two mangas, we've seen bad matchups and we've seen overwhelming, once again, Setsuna versus Ren, Kuroki versus Rihito, yada, yada, yada. Like, we have seen when a matchup is just like, listen, this guy is just way out of your fucking league and you're about to lose. You know what I mean? Like, there's no way you're beating this guy. So we saw it in this real championship tournament. And I think, once again, going back to the point that I outside universe, we are reading that as, oh, the best of the best of characters that we rank as S tier are in this tournament, not the whole in-universe explanation of the different organizations, you know? So had Hatsumi or Walker, someone transferred to the Icy Dragons or whatever and become the champion there, maybe that would be a thing. But they, as you said, we have a Cat 2 coming up. A lot of companies are like, I think we're going to save our fighters for the more important tournament. Why would they transfer out their guys? So,
yeah, anyways. But focusing a little bit more on the fight itself, because I think it's kind of interesting how the perspective on Sakigake has shifted. Like, time has really not been kind to this character, because I remember the first time this match was starting and people were saying Sakigake was going to be Nico number 3 or something. Like, there were, like, mad theories that he was a clone of someone I even saw some theories that he might be Lohan in disguise. It was crazy.
Really? I heard that about Ramon was an older third Nico, but I didn't hear that about Sakigake.
Yeah, the thing with Nico number 3, they just plaster any new character on Nico number 3. But Ramon, it was Sakigake.
It was Justin the whole time.
Well, whatever. What's interesting about that, because I remember I was doing the chapter breakdown and reviews for that fight. Mm-hmm. One of the things I found interesting about that fight, and it was a very weird thing, because this fight is a lot more, let's say, simplistic. That's probably why it has like a few chapters, because it really did boil down to Sakigake trying to hit Justin from like mid to long range, and Justin just not going down. And then Sakigake is sort of doing good. He's sort of, let's say, playing the Gao Lang game, sort of, if from like mid to long range. And Sakigake slips up at the last second of that fight. Because I don't think it was reasonable for Sakigake to know that like Justin had the neck strength that he had. Because like that was a pretty big, pretty amazing to see like the type of neck strength that Justin had. Because like that's the one thing that stopped, that explained why his scorpion kick didn't work. He expected that to be the KO moment, at least for him.
Yeah.
And Okubo even says that like Justin was lucky in that case. I guess, is it like...
But we could expect that from any wrestlers, like Jose and Seki and all them. Like, that's something that should be expected from someone with an amateur wrestling background. If he trained anything like Seki, then we know. And just like people making fun of the fact, like, he just kept rushing in and taking hits. You mean like fan favorite Seki always taking hits? Nobody complains when Seki just walks through punches and just like, keeps trying.
Has Sakigake, like, does he even know Sekabayashi? Like,
I'm not saying that. I'm not saying that. I'm just saying that, like, for a guy who's so clean on his own martial arts, maybe he should have recognized. I'm not saying that Sakigake is at fault for the scorpion tail landing and thinking it would be a KO move. I'm saying that when people complain, like, oh, his neck muscles are that strong, and oh, why does he just keep trying to get to him and keeps getting flown back and keeps taking the hit, I'm just like, well, we've been stated multiple times to come from an amateur wrestler background. All the wrestlers we've seen in the entire series have literally done this their muscles, their endurance, their durability. They stand there, they take hits, and we all think that's cool, that's fine, you know? But when Justin does it, a brand new character, it seems like, you know? So anyway, as you said, Scorpion Kick didn't work, and Sucky, like, why would he have studied amateur wrestling, to be fair? That's certainly not a beautiful sport from what we know of his background, you know?
And I specifically said, because it happened right before the final chapter of this fight, when we had that backstory and that entire thing, I remember because Sakigake still had his fans, he still had his following, and he kind of still had a following as well, even after Justin's defeat, until he got taken out by Ramon. But when I said, hey guys, I think Justin's gonna win because we've seen Sakigake. The most dangerous thing about Sakigake was that we didn't know anything about him. We know everything about him. We've gotten a flashback. We even know he's fighting philosophy. This man is cooked. A lot of people didn't believe me. And when it eventually happened, I saw so many Justin fans that did not exist before that. It was very funny to witness, actually. Like, the amount of support that came, like, I even remember, Griever, you liked Justin. You said that, like, from the beginning. Yeah. But I don't even think you thought he was going to win. I think you were cautious as well.
I picked Justin. So I've been correct in my prediction video. I predicted all four fights correctly, which goes along with the fact that I had a 93% overall pick when I first read Ashura. I got 93% of all those fights right as well. I'm very good at picking fights somehow. Maybe I should start betting on this shit. But I wanted Justin to win, but I had a strange feeling that for some reason Justin was going to lose. So I tentatively picked him, and I did say, I'm picking him. I'm not sure that he's going to win. You know, I wasn't very confident in that pick, but after we saw the fight, okay. But isn't that the excitement of a manga? You get two new characters. You don't really know their strengths, their styles, their personalities yet. Thing can happen, right? So I know the fight wasn't great. I understand that the fight itself was not that appealing or great to witness when we're talking such high tier fighters, but was it really that bad?
Well, we can judge it on two bases, and we're going to start with within the real champions tournament. I think it is flat out the worst fight in the real champions tournament. I think it's safe to say that. Maybe. Okay. Do you disagree?
I have the last fight as the worst.
Oh man, that's rough. Okay.
I have Lomon versus Ramon. We'll get there. We'll get there.
Yeah, we will get there.
I have this one. I have this one a close second to the bottom. I do agree. It's not a great fight.
Yeah.
I'm just saying it's not this negative 100 out of 10 that everyone's talking about. That's all I'm saying. The overarching hate makes me sort of devil's advocate push back a little much. That's all, you know?
Yeah, it is what it is when it comes to that fight. I guess we've already covered it mostly because, there really wasn't much in terms of the game plan of each fighter going into it. The most impressive thing, I guess, is this is the one thing we didn't talk about, is Justin's slam at the end was incredibly powerful. In fact, it was a lot more powerful than I actually imagined it would be. Because, like, I think it shook up the entire stadium. Yeah, it did. And that, to me, was like, whoa. Like, when I saw that suplex, I was like, yeah, Sakigake is done. He's not going to do anything. He's not getting up after that one. Like,
That was some back in the day. That was some Kaneko Man ultimate muscle shit. That was like holy shit. All right. Yeah. So I agree. Yeah. Yeah. He's not getting up after that.
Yeah. It shows that, like, Justin, even though, because we'll talk about this later on with our predictions for the future fights, Justin is packing some very lethal damage with what he can do. Because he can basically do, his main suit is like wrestling with a mixture of boxing there, because he does MMA. So it's going to be very interesting to see what else he can do and how much damage that does to his opponent. Because that was the most important part of that entire fight, in my opinion. The fact that he could just do one suplex and that was it. We're done. We're going home. Pack it up.
Yeah.
Like, that was crazy.
It just shows that, once again, just because all these guys are, and this is going back to the whole too much hate for this fight, is when you have a character who just has overwhelming, these are all different walks of life, might be masters of their own martial arts, but sometimes that doesn't mesh well. And sometimes in the face of sort of using a Julius Reinhold situation, which we're about to get into that fight, but
yeah.
Oh, martial arts, you're silly martial arts, you're this, that, the other thing, pales in comparison to simply overwhelming strength, you know? And it's just like, yeah, so yeah, you can, and this is sort of proving slightly a bit of Julius's point, is that, okay, yeah, he took hits. He took his hits to the face. He took his signature move, his best move. And then once he got a hold of him, slam, you're done, you know? And sometimes bad matchups happen and some people are just stronger than you. You know what I mean? Just overwhelmingly stronger.
Yeah.
And in that regard, is this a good fight? No.
Nah.
But is it this terrible, atrocious, Sandro should stop writing Omega period fight that people called it? Nah, I think that's going a little far, but that's just me. But yeah.
Yeah.
And I'm excited to see more of Justin. Are you, Dio? Are you excited to see more of Justin, like even after this tournament?
Depends. It depends on how he performs against with Gao Lang. My guess is that we will see him because he's sort of, his character direction seems to be like he's stuck between underground and, you know, the public. And I think he probably will fall in love with underground fighting and participating in these events because he's a dark horse. He still has a lot of room to grow. That's where I think his character is going. He's going to get this mad experience and he's just going to be a powerhouse in the future.
That's Would you argue that he should have probably actually been introduced in the Berserker Bowl of the rookies sort of idea rather than here?
Yeah, but who would you put as, like, the champion of his, like, underground arena? Because, like, at the same time, remember, you'd have to put a new character as well. Because the whole point of this is that they're incorporating, you know, people outside their own, you know, pool of fighters to do this.
But if this guy's been training under Okubo anyways, you could have just swapped him for Okubo in this tournament and you could add Justin in the Berserker Bowl and maybe had a better showing. That's all. Or not a better showing. So far, he's doing very well. But just in general, so we could have gotten more of his character up to this point is what I guess. But
It'll be interesting. I suspect that he might be too powerful for Berserker Bowl. It might be because he seems like, and I know it's a bit weird. He seems like he would be able to fight like people like Rito and Cosmo and Sawbang and would probably be able to beat him since they don't know what he's going to do.
True.
So it's like,
no.
They would be in trouble most of the time. At least that's how I would imagine it would play out. But then again,
they also have to
participate in the league as well. So maybe, no, actually no one in the league would be able to do anything to him as well. Because again, he is still the champion. I still have to give him that, at least that portrayal buff, let's say.
But very much so.
He could very much fit in with Berserk Bowl, but I think...
I just meant from a character perspective in the sense of, you know, we might not, let's just assume that he loses to Gao Lang in this next fight. Then we don't really have much to showcase him with. If they wanted to make Justin, which I think is a fun character, he's sort of like another Sao Pang. He's a little more boisterous. He's a little louder. He's, you know...
I love his one-liners.
He's a little more party guy sort of idea. It might have been nice to have introduced him earlier, whether in the Berserker Bowl or not. It just might have been nice to introduce him as a character at the very least earlier, so we saw a little bit more of him before this at the very least, because I do think he's just a little more, he adds a certain level of like Sao Pang energy to this fight, a very stoic, very, I'm a master martial artist, I speak in a deep solemn voice and I never raise my voice whatsoever. Yeah. I am Jirota, master of swing. I am Gao Lang, master of boxing. I am Agito, the fang, you know, like everybody is just calm, collected, cool. And here's Justin being like, let's go for a party, boys. He's got that energy.
He has that energy.
Right. He's dialing it up to 11 and he's got that bit of energy. And I just think that he's a nice contrast in this tournament. Whether people think he belongs in this tournament or not, I think his energy and his vibe sets him apart. And I just sort of assuming that, you know, we're not going to see much more of him after a fight. I just think that it's kind of a shame in that regard, because then we're going to go back to basically all this thing.
We're talking like he's already been defeated. We're going to talk about
this later. True. I said assume. I did say assume.
We'll talk about Justin a little bit more later, because he is sort of the dark horse of this tournament. Like, I think it's pretty clear now. And there might be some, let's say, crackpot ideas of Justin being... You know, let me not even say it now, even though you're probably thinking what I'm thinking when it comes to that. Hopefully you are. But let's go into Julius versus Agito. Oh, boy. You know what? I want to hear your thoughts on this one first.
This is obviously the second best fight in the real tournament so far. I know there's only four fights, but it's right up there for me with Gao Lang versus Arashiyama. I really like the fight. And it went from a 7 to an 8 for me after the conclusion of the fourth fight, because of the simple reason that when I saw Julius versus Agito, I thought, okay, Agito's going to win because narratively speaking, he just lost. He's the fifth Fang. He's the badass. Everybody loves him. No way Sandro makes him lose twice in a row. But I think he was going to suffer some heavy damage. I thought that Julius was going to, his whole not Kuroki Gensai, not Wakatsuki, not even the Fang, you know, and all this stuff will, like, I'm overwhelmingly powerful. I'm going to show them that their martial arts and all this crap, my overwhelming strength is going to dominate you, right? Now, I do like the mountain, the evolution, the whole showing that, no, the ceiling is way higher than you all thought, and now you have something more to strive for in this fight. Was absolutely fantastic. Just like with the Gao Lang showcasing that pre-initiative isn't the answer to all your problems, in the same sense that all these characters are only so under Shen because they already all thought they reached the top of the mountain, their pinnacle, their ceiling. It was reached. There was no higher heights to find. Now that they know there's a vast mountain range left to climb, everyone's improving in leaps and bounds because they know it exists now. They've seen it with their own eyes. They know it's a reality. It's not a fantasy. It's not a pipe dream. So that was showcased in this fight. It was fantastic. And Julius did showcase a lot of great things. The only problem with this fight was actually a causality of Ramon being such a bitch in the fourth fight, because I really thought that bear hug that he did would do a lot more damage. I appreciated Julius being like, oh, I'm going to take your hits. And he took dragon shots. He took dragon's vane, which, by the way, is actually a move in the Nico style, technically speaking. It's a different move, but there is a move called dragon's vane. I thought that was very strange. Two moves named the same thing. And also just like, it was just a really good fight that Agito was... He had to constantly utilize his formless, because taking a hit from this master, this German suplex of a man, was just not... It was amazing to me that it's like everyone thinks it was such a dominating fight. And sure, the technicality won over, but I really do think it was to set up. And I think this was part of the mistake. And that's why the fight could have been better. And it's why it's under Gao Lang versus Jirota for me, is that Julius would have had a better showing and done more lasting damage to Agito had Roland not sweeped his opponent, because going into the next round, everyone would have argued and it would have just set fire to the community had Agito versus Roland happened and Agito went in weak and Roland was unscathed. We couldn't have that happen, so Sandro made it that Julius couldn't do any real lasting damage to Agito, where he knew he was already setting up Lolong to beat the shit out of Ramon with no difficulty.
Wow.
So as a result of that, I think Julius fans, I'm sorry you got done a little dirty, but I still think your boy got a pretty good showing. Agito had to be on his toes, use every technique, use his best moves multiple times to take this man out. It might have looked like a no difficult fight. I don't know what manga you're reading if you think that was no diff for Agito. Agito had to try his damnedest and be on his toes. One split second would have, you know, he would have been caught unawares and he would have been ring out or knocked out or anything like that. You know what I mean? So I thought the fight was right there. I know they make fun of it in the memes, but the razor thin margin. Yeah, it was there. It kind of was. A split second going left instead of right would have spelled disaster for Agito. So I thought it was a pretty good fight for a guy who's not a huge Julius fan either. He's fine. I'm not like with him or for him or against him or anything. He's just there. He's another character. He's a powerhouse. And, you know, but I just thought he had a pretty good showing. So round three for me, or fight three, was, as I said, the second best fight. Yeah, had we not been trying to set up the two kings versus each other for the next round, both being of relatively the same amount of health or healthy, then I do think Julius might have had a better showing. But that's just it for me.
Wow, I really didn't expect Ramon to catch any strays so early. Like, you are ready to slander Ramon. Like, it's like you were like,
oh, yeah.
I'm here. I'm going to let the world know how I feel about Ramon. But I somewhat disagree, because I did make a defense of the razor of Yamashita's last words. I think this fight was pretty one-sided. In fact, this is going to be a little bit, I might get in trouble with Julius fans, but I loved it when Agito was beating the shit out of Julius in this fight. It gave me joy in my heart to see it happen. But what was interesting about that fight is that it was one-sided up until, like, Julius started, you know, getting that temporary power boost. But even then, even in that case, like, Agito was in control still until, like, maybe you could argue the final exchange where, you know, Agito has to shift towards the, I think it was the left of Julius in order to knock him out. Now, that's really the closest Agito came to defeat, which, again, we do know Julius can one-shot Agito, right? He could probably do it. But
probably
every other time, he wasn't even close. He wasn't doing anything to Agito really much at all. Although he did come close in a few areas, he wasn't cutting it time and time again. And that's really the thing about this fight that was, I guess, I can see where Julius fans would get frustrated, even though, like, most people will like this fight. It is what it is there. I'm not a Julius fan. I love this fight. I loved seeing Agito getting his ass handed to him. So I guess what I want to hear your thoughts on, because this hasn't been explained yet, we saw something very interesting in this match, and that is that Agito is using Formless, but Yamashita hints at the fact that it's not just Formless that's going on. And you can kind of tell, because whenever Agito is using Formless, in fact, I think whenever anyone is using Formless, they sort of have that expression change. You know that expression change where they kind of look kind of evil? Mm-hmm. But Agito doesn't have that expression when he's fighting against Julius. Well, do you have any theories on that? Because that's something that was odd and it's not explained. I'm guessing it's going to be explained in his fight against Lo Long. But what are your thoughts on what is going on there?
Well, just before we touch on that, I do want to say that, just so we're clear, I do agree the fight was somewhat was. I'm not saying that Julius would have ever beat Agito. I still think Agito would come out on top at any point in the series against Julius. I just think that bear hug he got and all that stuff would have done far more lasting damage to a man who doesn't have Superman syndrome. We've seen what a bear hug did to Waka. I just think that he, narratively speaking, Julius could have done a lot more lasting damage by the next fight to Agito had we not been trying to set up, all right, the King of the Kangen and King of Purgatory finally getting to square off. We want them to be of, you know, that was my only thing about that. But I do think Agito wins 10 out of 10 times against Julius. High diff or not, low diff or not. But yeah, the Formless thing, what I think it is as Kuroki was mentioning how in the fight against, what's his name? The guy from Purgatory there, Lu Tan. Yeah, he shrunk the gap even further than he did in his fight against Kroki between Master of Martial Arts and Formless and stuff, right? And we saw that. He was shrinking the gap. And now I believe he's evolved Formless to the point it's not stated. And as you said, like, we can theorize it all day. What I like to think is that this is either one of two things. Agito has actually mastered Formless mixed with martial arts with no time lag, hence the expression. So there is no lag to take advantage of. Or he has mastered Formless as in he's no longer a beast while using it. He's actually calmed the beast within. I know it sounds cheesy, but the uncontrollable rage has been harnessed in a sense. You don't go crazy using it. It's not like advanced Oma early on, or, you know, the crazy removal and stuff like that, or anything like that. Like, Formless always made you go a little, okay, I'm going wild, I'm going a little divine demon, I'm going a little batshit nuts. And this is Formless under complete sanity control.
Yeah.
Those are my two theories on it. The first one to me is more likely, but because we saw he was still using Formless to dodge and immediately using techniques, using moves.
Actually, so that's something I also wanted to bring attention to, because when Julius is about to charge at him, you know, while there's still some distance between them, he uses Formless to just dodge, and right after that, he uses the Dragon Shot, which is why...
Dragon Shot, immediately.
Yes, immediately. And no expression change, right?
Nope. So that's why I think that he eliminated the time lag.
Yeah.
That's his advancement. That's his way. Yeah.
Yeah. There is no time lag at all. But also I'm thinking maybe he combined both of these two things in that way where they're not.
Oh, that's what I mean too. Like,
yeah.
Right. He's transformed Formless to incorporate. Sorry, I should have made myself more clear. Yeah, that's what I mean. He's eliminated the time lag, meaning he doesn't need to switch between them. When he uses Formless, he can still use his martial arts while in Formless. It's seamless. It's been transformed and combined to elevate Formless. He's calling it because Formless is Agito's style at the end of the day. Yes, he can use martial arts, but his style has always been Formless. It's what he was taught. He was also taught the Nico style, but we never think of Agito as a Nico style user. He's a Formless user. That's his main style. So I like to think that, yeah, he's just incorporated all his martial arts into Formless and elevated Formless into this new style Formless, which incorporates being able to use Dragon Shot, Dragon's Vein, whatever, and all these moves. You know what I mean? So I think it's the most likely scenario. And I sort of wish we had found out more about that because it seemed to be open-ended during the fight. It's odd that they brought it up and never concluded it. But as you said, in the... where it's going to be pre-initiative versus pre-initiative, king versus king in the next fight, maybe we'll get more information on how he's evolved Formless then.
Yeah, my guess is that they're saving it until then. Because, like, there's also some stuff with Lo Long. I also think it's confirmed by Ramon himself that, like, nah, he still has things in his bag as well. So we're going to be seeing some new stuff from both of them and some explanations for stuff that they can do, you know, with their various twists. But...
agreed.
I guess in closing, because it seems like there really isn't much to say about this fight.
It was drawn really well. I thought the choreography could be argued some of the best out of, like, the art style, some of the panels and stuff. When Julius was coming down on Agito and Agito was going up and stuff, were some of the best so far in the tournament. I feel confident in making the statement that, yeah, some of the art was some of the best. But, I think we sort of covered everything for that fight. As I said, that's, I think, what people wanted in Gerarda versus Gao Lang. They wanted a slugfest, and they got one here, so.
Well, it turned out to be more of a one-sided beatdown, but hey, you know.
One-sided beatdown, yeah, yeah.
I guess the only thing we haven't covered is the whole mountain scaling thing and the power amp situation. Because maybe we can talk a little bit about it now, because this seems like something that may affect the rest of the series. How do you think it's going to impact, I'm saying the rest of the series, I mean the rest of this tournament, maybe. Do you think, because like Julius got stronger as he was fighting Agito, like he got a Zenkai boost basically from Dragon Ball. And so, do you think it's possible for other characters? Because we're going to talk about Justin versus Gao Liang again. But do you think maybe, because we know it's probably not going to happen with, let's say, Agito or Lo Long, or maybe it might happen with them, you never know. But how do you think that entire narrative point will end up being, you know, how will it manifest in the story?
I think it's going to be subtle in some cases, and other cases it's going to be very obvious, like as you pointed out, basically a Zenkai boost in with Julius and stuff. Sometimes we're going to see it, sometimes we're not. Once again, I think it's more of the mental, like Yan explained it about three times in that chapter, three different ways. And a lot of them, they all made sense. The biggest one wasn't for me the mountain one. It was the runner's one, because that was the thing for a long time. And I forget lad's name. I think it was Bolt who did it. But the 100 meter dash was always nobody beat 10 seconds. Nobody beat 10 seconds. It was impossible to do 100 meters in under 10 seconds. One guy did it. All of a sudden, everybody's doing it. This past Olympics, everybody was under 10 seconds. So it's like, were all those guys just slow before? No, it was this mental block. It was a mental block that this was the end. And it's the perfect example, because these are athletes at the end of the day. They're martial artists and stuff. But at the end of the day, we can encompass them as athletes, at artists of their craft. And if you have a mental block that you think you've reached the top, there is no getting, it's not possible to do it faster. It's not possible to, like if you mentally block yourself saying it's impossible, then you'll never achieve. You'll never grow. And I think that because of Shen, and as Yan explained, because of the reveal of the connector, it literally allowed everyone. Some people are going to have smaller gains because some people were not close to Shen in the regard of like the gap being so close, like they can give him a fight yet. But guys like Agito, Oma, Kuroki and stuff don't need to improve as much as other characters. So I think what we're going to see is characters who, like Rahito in the end of the Berserker Bowl there. We saw his Kuroki saying, this is how you reach mastery. And we saw it happen in real time. I think we're going to see similar things happen to some characters. But in the case of some of the more like the top five and top 10, I doubt where it's going to be so blatantly obvious, but it is going to be there in the strictest sense. And it might not be overall stated every single time. Like, Oma's improved so much. Like, that's not the same Nico style he's had his whole time, you know, or anything like that. We're not going to get these outlandish statements. But yeah, I think it's good that we showcase that and explain that. Yeah, because that's a real thing. Just like the yips and athletes and stuff. It's a real phenomenon where it's like, you know, this is the limit. This is the ceiling. This, and now everyone's improving. And that could be the reason, not only the loss to Jiroda, but also the reveal of Shen. It could be the reason we're seeing this new formless in Agito right then and there. That could be a correlation. Yan sort of hints at that as well. So there's so much room for improvement, knowing that the ceiling now, ever since Shen showed up on the scene, now that we know the ceiling is so high, there's so much potential for everybody to grow. And that's kind of cool, assuming that the manga's not ending anytime soon. That's really good for so many characters.
It's probably not, because, you know, like, we still have the Annihilation Part 2. So it's like, yeah, we ain't done anytime soon.
I agree. But yeah, what are you thinking? Like, that explanation? Because I thought Yan gave us multiple analogies, multiple examples. And I thought, even though I don't like Yan as a character, and I think people overhype him, I like that he gave us so many versions of basically saying, yeah, this happens in real life and it's a thing. And Shen revealing himself literally was saying, yeah, here's the Michael Jordan of fighting. You guys can be that good. It is possible, you know?
Yeah.
And it's like, oh, okay.
Yeah, it is very interesting, because like Shen already had an influence on this tournament already. Like, this tournament literally got recontextualized as, we need a fighter that is able to go up against Shen. Whereas previously, before we even, you know, before Shen Wulong and the Worm and Death Dealers revealed themselves to the Kengan Association, it was just another tournament that was going to happen. So
yeah,
there's already that influence. And then there's the power difference or the power that Agito sort of experienced because he was with Kuroki and Lolong in their raid against the Connector. So he saw how powerful Shen Wulong was. And we sort of see this thing where it's like, even Yan said at some point that it looks like it's spreading. So like Agito has sort of, by making it into this tournament, he sort of raised the bar for everyone else. Like, The other half of this tournament, you know, Gao Lang, Jirada, and the Justin and Sakigake side, I would argue they seem to be behind, in my opinion. It seems like the harder place to fight in this tournament is the side where Lolong and Agito exist. So,
I agree 100%. Yes.
So it's like, those guys might need an amp, so I can see Sandrovich doing that. You know, having Agito come in there, showcase this insane level of power that comes from the influence of the Connector. So the Connector influences this tournament in another way again, for the sake of everyone getting stronger in this ghoul ritual type of tournament. So I think it was good in that way as well. I am waiting to see how it bears fruit for the end of the tournament. But we'll talk about that in our predictions as well.
Well, I do think that, You're absolutely right about that. And, Kazi Yamagohan the Great himself literally said exactly what you're saying, is that this tournament, people should evolve. But even before we got the Yan explanation, he was saying, it's like, during this tournament, they are going to fight all against themselves, the highest level fighters, guys who can take them to the brink. And hopefully they improve by improving each other, and they get stronger and better and faster and stuff, because we need someone to fight against Shen. So he already said exactly what you're saying. And yeah, as you said, the real tournament sort of turned into we're going to set the best of the best up against each other in the hopes that they just get that much stronger. So maybe we have a shot at them, you know?
That brings us to the last match of this tournament. Well, I'll let you go on your Ramon slander. Let's hear it. Lolong versus Ramon.
Okay. All right. So my problem isn't exactly with Ramon. Well, it is. It is a bit.
Yeah, it is.
Okay. So the reason that Julius didn't do lasting damage was because the only man that everyone, the moment saw the eight fighters revealed for this tournament, everyone said, Justin ain't gonna do shit. He's discount Okubo. Sakigake's a twink looking motherfucker. He's gonna get broken in half in the first fight. Ramon, third Nico. He's gonna be great. He's gonna give Lolong a run for money. He's gonna be the great. He's gonna have some crazy martial art. He's gonna be really strong. He's the dark horse. He's our new Kuroki Gensai. And then we got the fight. And maybe I got to stop being part of the community or something for a time. I have no idea. But when Roland beat the ever-loving shit out of this man, we get a backstory. Dude was, I guess, born in the wrong country and decided, I'm going to join a military that kind of sucks and I can't curb my bloodlust. So I'm going to go to another country and do that and stuff like that. It's like, yeah, you should have figured that out a long time ago. The man's just insane. He's just like, I want to blood, more blood. Like, he just, and then he goes into this like idea of, oh yes, I have all these technical, I have Krav Maga and I'm ready to go and stuff like that. And Roland's like, no, you ain't got shit. Like, you come in my long range, I can fight you at long range. You come in my mid range, I can fight you at mid range. And you come close to me, I'm going to knock you the fuck out. So what did he bring to the table again? Like, all he did was knock out a guy who already got knocked out in one hit by Justin. And then he comes into the match all like blood crazed, like, oh, is it my blood? Was I damaged? Or is this the blood of my opponent? Who knows? Ha ha ha. I've been waiting for a fight of this caliber, waiting for a fight against someone like you. And boom, gets his absolute shit kicked. And my problem with that is that Ramon was the one guy that everybody was hyping up that might, out of the three new characters, he was going to be the guy. He was going to be the guy that was actually going to deserve to be in the tournament. You know, everyone was saying, no, Justin and Sakigake, they don't deserve to be in this tournament. Where's Hatsumi? Where's Waka? Where's these guys? And then we get this guy, and he's the most disappointing out of all of them. His character sucks. Looking at him without a beard, I was like, oh my god, what inbred, family did he come from? And then I just, and once again, this is the reason why the bear hug and the couple attacks Julius actually got off on Agito, seemingly Agito walks away totally fine from, is because I didn't realize that when Roland fought in his match, he was going to not get hit at once. And Roland was going to walk away 100% healthy. No wonder Julius had to have a bad show, because they were never going to. Sandro's not stupid enough to set up, okay, we have Agito, king of the Kengan matches, the fifth Fang Matsudo, finally up against the true king of purgatory, Roland Donaire, but Agito's only at 70%. No way was he going to do that to the fan base. No fucking way was he going to pull that stunt. So, because no matter what happened, it was going to make somebody look really fucking bad. So he said, no, I have to bring these two into this fight at 100%. So he had to make Julius look somewhat bad, because he was going to make Ramon an absolute bitch. And that's my biggest problem with this fight, is that Ramon could have actually done a little damage. His Krav Maga, he could have gotten underneath the invisible level. He could have done something to Roland. He could have been like, oh no, he is a dark horse. He is really fucking strong. And Roland managed to get a lucky punch in, and Roland's like, holy shit, like this dude was not kidding or something. Or they could have had Sakigaki actually do some damage to Ramon. Ramon comes into the fight and Roland gives the whole line, you know, at the end of the fight of, maybe if you hadn't been damaged, I would have, you know, blah, blah, blah. But people were calling that out too. And I'm just like, I don't think there was any way to win with this guy, but making him absolutely like the biggest loser next to Sakigaki in this tournament. What was the point of introducing three new characters when we already have guys like Waka, like Hatsumi, like Mikuzuchi, like Oma? What was the point in having all these high tier fighters fight against these absolute losers? It just makes no sense. We had so many other guys who could have entered this tournament in their place. Okubo, Seki, we could have, you know, Sal Pang. We could have had Rahito at this point, now that he's mastered his martial arts, you know. We had so many more viable options that would have given some of these fighters a much harder fight. So though I disagree that every fight needs to be, when people say every single fight needs to be high difficulty and stuff, this one just... Oh, Ramon was the biggest disappointment. I held out hope that Ramon actually do something, and he was literally a shit character with a shit backstory and then did absolutely nothing. So, and now he's out. So, but that being said, there is a highlight. There is a silver lining of all this. We finally have Agito versus Roland. So, and I think a lot of people, ever since KVP, ever since we were introduced to Purgatory, I think people have been excited for that matchup. That's a matchup a lot of people have wanted to see for a long time. So, eh.
I guess I'll do a little bit of, let's say, Ramon apologetics, because I was hyped for this fight, and I also was disappointed by it. However, I never expected Ramon to do, I wasn't expecting him to be powerful. I was expecting him to be a lot more underhanded and dirty as a fighter. And that is because he's from Slaughter Coliseum, and I think you're reading Star Strike and Rich, right? Like, I think you're caught up.
Yes, I am. Yep.
So you
I'm even, I started reviewing it actually too.
Yeah, so you've seen like the female side of Slaughter Coliseum, where they have, you know, these underhanded tactics, quote unquote, where they don't exactly play by the books, right? And that's the one thing I was like, okay, Ramon is going to be that guy that won't necessarily play by the books. And I was wondering how Lo Long was going to deal with someone like that. And I actually mentioned it in like the beginning of this fight, where Ramon just straight up just says like, look, I'm trying to kill you, right? Whereas the threat of death wasn't on anyone else in this tournament, right? Like the fight between, let's say, Gao Leng and Jirada, it was a high div fight. Those people were probably willing to, you know, fight to the death, but no one's trying to kill each other per se, right? Mm-hmm. Ramon is trying to do that with Lo Long, and it makes the performance sting that much more.
Yeah, the fact that he's like, oh no, I'm not here to fight you. I'm here to make you bleed. I'm here to kill you. And then he doesn't even get...
He does nothing. I think he has the worst performance, just flat out, right? Because I thought the person who performed the worst was Julius. I was like, yeah. Because Julius was just losing. Ah, he's doing lose. And then with Ramon, it was like, he never got close. And I think that's really the craziest part about this, because notice how we've gone from, let's say, the beginning of this tournament. Gerardo versus Gao Lang is a high diff fight. Then you go to Justin versus Sakagake around mid diff, right? Around there. Then you have Julius versus Agezo, where it's like, oh yeah, low diff probably, but let's say we're pushing it mid diff. And then you go to this one and it's like low diff at best.
No diff.
At best.
At best. Not even. Not even.
Yeah, it's like
that wasn't a fight. That wasn't a fight. That was Roland saying, "I'll play with you for a while. Yeah. I'm waiting to fight Agito." Like that's all that was. It was a joke. It was an absolute joke of a fight. And then the fact that we wasted chapters on this guy, gave him backstory, gave him aura, gave him an actual Doomsday Messenger aura. I'm gonna kill you. I'm gonna make you bleed. I'm gonna do this. It's like. And if Sandro thought, it's like, okay, I need to show, like, Roland is a competitor. He's, like, super strong, and I need to show that he's got a fight in him and stuff. It's like, this is not the way to do it. Is not to show him beating the shit out of a character we've never known about. And then literally, all it does is make that character look bad. It doesn't make Roland look good. Roland doesn't look any worse for it, but he also doesn't look any better. Had Roland done this same treatment to a known character, then it would have added credence that, okay, Roland, like all the shit talkers can shut up. Roland knows what he's fucking doing, well, you know, but now it's not doing anything for him because we, you know, you either had high expectations for Ramon or you didn't. One way or another, you're either disappointed or you don't care. So it did, this fight did nothing for the story.
Well,
it did nothing.
To be fair, I think, you know, looking at it from Ramon's side, he's literally up against the monster of Manila. And we know Lolong is a dominant fighter. Like, he's so dominant. This man had, like, I think it was 400 plus wins. And when Medel is, like, in Kengen versus Purgatory tournament, he's like, dog, I feel bad for whoever's going to fight Lolong. Right? Like, he's seen this man dominate his fighters for so long that he thought beating Lolong wasn't even something that could happen. Until, of course, Oma does it. But it's like, he was dominant. You know, at least
I agree.
That's his background.
Yeah.
And I have a feeling. I had a feeling as well that I think a lot of characters could have ended up like Ramon, if not worse. The problem
I agree.
That it doesn't really, it makes Ramon's, let's say, performance pretty bad because he doesn't have the background. He has like one win against Sakagake, a character that is
got
his
shit kicked by a character. Right?
Yeah.
If we don't see the problem, here's what I'll say about the problem with characters. Not the problem of introducing new characters. Introducing new characters is a fantastic idea. It expands the world. You have a lot more to play with, whether they're good written or indifferent, it doesn't matter. Introducing new characters usually is a good thing because now you have a bigger cast to play with. The problem is that when you have martial arts, when you have fights, when you have things like this, is when we introduce these new characters, we have no, as you said, background to these characters. We have no credibility to these characters. Justin could give Sekibayashi a run for his money, but I don't know that because I haven't seen it. We've never seen it. So since we haven't seen it or been told it, we don't know it. So is Sakigake super fucking weak or is Justin really fucking strong? We don't know because we have no frame of reference. If you don't, in anything, mathematics, accounting, athletics, it doesn't matter. If you don't have a frame of reference, if you don't have a matrix to set up and say, okay, here's where our baseline is. If we don't have a baseline, we don't know where to rank anything. We already know that Roland is strong as shit. And as you said, many characters would have gotten the Ramon treatment against Roland. The problem is, where does Ramon's stake be? Is he D tier, C tier, B tier, A tier? We don't know because he went up against an S tier.
Yeah.
So the problem is that there was no purpose in his character if that's the case, if you don't establish a baseline. And that is the biggest problem with trying to use new characters against veterans without showcasing them in at least one initial fight first. Because then you just have a fight like this where nobody cares now. Nobody's invested. If Ramon continues in any chapter of the story, nobody's going to care. Any fans he might have had are already gone.
Because
you've already established his baseline.
They retired a right. long time ago.
Exactly. Yeah, and it's really sad. And the problem is he doesn't have enough charisma to stay around like a character, for example. Like, I know a lot of people shit on Nezu. I like Nezu, the whole Mickey Mouse thing. Like, he was part of Dreamland, you know, the whole doing the Disney thing and stuff. And he was a gangster and he got married and shit. Like, I'm happy to hear that in the bonus volumes. He got married and, you know, he's living his good life. Yeah, he can still probably fight, but he was never on Mikazuchi's level. That's okay. That doesn't make him a shitty character or whatever, but he was just out of his league. Okay. But he didn't have the character, the charisma, the crying guy who just wanted to believe in Disney World. You know what I mean? Like, Ramon's just a generic, I want to fight and kill things. I'm the guy who at 6 years old was twisting the heads off of rats I found in the sewers. Like, I've seen that character 1,000 times. He wasn't interesting in 1977. He's not interesting now. So, like, it just didn't, like, I have a question for you then. Like, what did round four, or what did fight four here actually add to the tournament? Did it actually give us anything? You know, each fight, I would argue, gave us something, except this one.
Well, I would say this. I guess I'll talk about the positives while I'm at it, because there are a few things that I liked about this fight, right? The first one is the choreography between Ramon and Lo Long, because they both specialize in like close quarters combat, sort of. And seeing their exchange at like the beginning of the fight, that to me was very nice. It was very cool. I very much like that exchange. I know some people may not be a fan of that type of choreography. I thought it was pretty good overall.
I agree. Yeah, choreography was pretty good.
Yeah.
I'll agree with, yeah, fair.
The second thing is that this really did bring out Lo Long's personality, because like, ever since he got beaten by Oma, I think people have seen it that he has a lot more one-liners. He's a lot more funny. That's something where it's like, cause like Agito, yes, he's a cool guy, but Lo Long has that savagery about him that I sort of like to see in his matches from now on. And he's also smiling a lot more, cause I don't even remember him smiling much in Kengan versus Purgatory. So.
Oh, he never did.
Yeah.
He didn't smile once.
Yeah, so because he was in his depressed phase, right? Because he wasn't losing at all. And the people that he fought were just falling like flies, like Ramon right now.
Yeah.
So from those two perspectives, I sort of like that, right? Those are the two things I like about this. In terms of like a positive overall, it's hard. I have to think about it because they're...
Okay.
There is a thing where I'm like, maybe Ramon is going to do something, but that is the cope within me that I probably don't want to inhale. I don't want to inhale that cope. It's too much. But yeah, the fight, I wouldn't say it's necessarily a waste, because I can see Ramon as sort of like, I don't know, a childish version of Lo Long. Like how a person who is faking like their Lo Long would be. That's how it seems like to me. That's how I thought of Ramon. But that's really about it. I
think what...
You can tell I'm scraping the bottom of the barrel here.
Yeah, I mean, but fair enough, fair enough. I mean, I've played Devil's Advocate video. So, I mean, you know, you got to give some pushback. I just think that, like, Julius could have done a little more damage to Agito. And in their fight, and then in Roland, had he fought anybody else, like even like, let's say he wins, let's say he fights against Hatsumi or Mikitsuchi or someone who could actually give him a fight and do some damage, then both of them go into the fight injured. I would have much preferred that than Julius having not so great a showing, plus Ramon. So all three characters. And once again, since we, as I've said before, we never established a baseline for these three new characters. So is Justin C, B, A, S tier? We have no idea. And we know that Sakigaki and Ramon are shit. That's all we've learned so far. So the new characters introduced, we will never care about them. All right, great. Let's move on. You know what I mean? So that's my one big issue with that. I think you could have given us two new characters, swapped out one of the three, knowing that none of them are really going to do much. And with a familiar face, and maybe giving one of the other fighters just a harder time. That's all. But, you know, I mean, hindsight's 20/20. and you never know what's happening on in the writer's room, so.
I guess the only thing, and we'll just move on after this point, is both Agito and Lo Long saw the connector fight, so they would already have a boost to their already insane skill.
Right.
So, as I said earlier in this conversation, Julius and Ramon had their work cut out for them. They are the unlucky ones here. They fought against people who are already the best of the best, who are basically got exposed to the god of the verse and have gotten a Zenkai boost because of it. And these characters that have been around doing their own things in their own world, they are not aware of any of this, are now having to fight these guys, and they're getting washed. It's like,
true.
I don't want to be too hard on Julius and Ramon, because I think,
but you're not wrong. Who in the verse can beat Roland? Like, realistically, like, not to get into a whole discussion, but when you put it that way, you're making actually a lot of sense. Like, there's not a whole lot of cats who you're going to say, yeah, they can beat Agito and they can beat Roland. So when you put it that way, it's like, yeah, there's only a handful of people that can actually fight them toe to toe to begin with. So, yeah, you know what? Fair enough. Fair enough. That's some good pushback there, Dio. Yeah.
It is what it is there. But let's go on, because we've been talking for a while, man. This is a fun conversation to have, though.
You can cut this up into multiple videos.
Nah, I want it to be one long-ass video that takes forever.
One long-ass.
Although I probably will cut it up as well. You know, you can have the best of both worlds.
True.
Either way, let's go into our predictions for Gao Lang versus Justin. What do you think?
Well, I said it in the last review, since I think we both agreed that we didn't think the fight was going to happen chapter. We thought the fight was going to start next chapter, you know. Maybe we were going to have a little more setup. So I was a little surprised that we actually didn't just start the fight. We got underway with the fight.
Yeah.
But here's what I think is going to happen. Since we know that whoever fights, that Agito and Roland, whoever wins, they're both going to beat the ever-loving shit out of each other. So that's a very even fight. Knowing that, what I think is going to happen here in round one, or fight one of round two, is Gao Lang is going to win. He's going to win pretty handily, knowing what we know now of chapter 275. But one of the ace in the holes, that maybe both, maybe one, is going to connect, and it's going to heavily damage Gao Lang's legs. We've already seen him take damage to his fists and all that stuff, and the whole thing about it, he now has the unbreakable fist. He's got the god claw. He's not going to damage his striking. What's he going to damage is his footwork, and that's going to be the thing. We're going to have a heavily injured Roland and or Agito up against a Gao Lang who has his striking, got flash, he's got god glow, but he's going to be injured from the waist down in some description. Either his legs, his footwork, he's going to be slow, his flexibility is going to be down, his speed is going to take a hit, something like that. And that's how that fight's going to end. I think Gao Lang's going to win this pretty decisively, but he's going to take a very damning hit going into the finals.
Yeah, well, I'm actually split between Justin and Gao Lang, and I know that's going to be surprising for some people to hear, because I think this really does depend on whether or not Justin can take advantage of the aces that he has, and the degree he's able to also grow as a fighter, because that's one of the things Justin is here to do. What's important about this tournament is that they are trying to create, you know, the fighter that could go up against Shen. So we're assuming that people are going to grow in power in this tournament. In fact, it's already happened with like Julius. So the winner of this tournament would likewise be someone who has grown in power as well. Maybe, and this is gonna be a wild take, it could be Justin if he's the dark horse of this tournament. Where, I know it might sound a little bit insane, again, if he does beat someone like Gao Lang, I don't think he'll win the entire tournament outright, but it would be, I don't think it's completely out of the cards. I think Justin stands a very good shot Because remember, Sakigake, he lost because he made one mistake in the fight. And he got into that suplex and that was it. What happens if Gao Lang makes a similar mistake and he gets into a similar position? Like, let's say, for example, let me ask you, Griever, if Gao Lang had taken the same slam that Sakigake had taken, do you think he would have gotten knocked out?
Since he's taken Jirota's swing, I'd say yes. He would get up. Heavily damaged, he would get up.
Damn, that's...
But his legs would be extremely weak after that one. I think he gets up. I think he loses, if we're talking like RPG health bars, I think he loses 80% of his health from a hit like that. But he, yeah, I don't think he gets knocked out in one hit like Sakigake did. Gao Lang's been thrown by the best and he's been, you know, hit by the best and stuff like that. I don't think Justin can come in and one-hit KO a guy like Gao Lang, no matter what move he uses. But that being said, the idea of Justin winning is definitely an interesting take. I kind of like it because, once again, I am a Justin fan. I like Justin. But I'm more curious on what these aces in the hole are. That's what's... curious to me. And if he's going to be able to, because once again, even against a guy with pre-initiative, even against one of the two kings of purgatory, a guy has to be careful to touch. Gao Lang controlled, as we both agreed, he controlled 95% of his match. What's to say, and we're seeing the domination right now, will he even be able to, like, he doesn't know what his aces in the hole are, but what is... Gao Lang's going to have to literally go brain dead for him to make a mistake that big to create such a big opening. You know what I mean? Like, it's just the fight is not in Justin's favor, I guess, is my... Like, he's got to wait for the perfect opening. Do what Jirota did and wait for a God Glow and use that opening to your advantage, maybe? Something similar? Seems to be the only bet. I mean, he did manage to dodge Black for a second, and then Okubo was like, oh shit, no, don't do that. And then he took a hit to the temple. So, I mean, you know, I just don't know if Justin's going to be able to get a opening. That's all.
Well, I am just talking about mere possibilities here. Because, like, for example, the difference between, let's say, Justin and Jirota is that Gao Lang knew what to expect with Jirota. He really didn't have anything new besides striking, which you couldn't really use against Gao Lang. With Justin, there are basically two things he doesn't know. And depending on what those things are, that's why I used the Sakigake example, where he accidentally landed on basically a landmine. And he was done, basically. And it really does come down to, like let's say, certain mistakes that Gao Lang might make that might not even necessarily be Gao Lang's fault. So that's what I'm talking about specifically. Like, can Justin take advantage of those moments?
Now, of the fact that he doesn't know what his trump cards are.
Yes.
So he doesn't know what to look out for.
Yes, and when he starts taking an advantage, he just shuts down anything Gao Lang can do at that moment. Because if he forces Gao Lang to start playing his game, the wrestling game, Gao Lang might be cooked. However,
Gao Lang has his Muay Thai. Gao Lang has his Muay Thai, so getting him on the ground, as we've seen before, trying to get him on the ground, he's able to cushion even the swing when it came out of nowhere. I don't think Justin, with his wrestling or getting him on the ground, I don't think any of that's going to matter because he's got the 8 points of contact. And no matter how much MMA training Justin has done, this man is a master of Muay Thai. So there's no position where...
Justin does have that high endurance.
He does, but I'm saying that, like, you know, honestly, the one thing that I could see that I don't know if Justin's going to pull off, I'm curious if he's going to pull a Cosmo. If he's going to go for a hold to just make him pass out.
That could be the one thing
I could see that would work against Gao Lang is being a strangler. If you strangled him, I don't know how Gao Lang gets out of a hold. I see him getting off the ground. I see him getting out of grapples. I don't see him getting out of an actual successful hold. We've never seen Gaolang in a hold because he's too fast. But if that's one of Justin's ace in the hole and he sees an opportunity to get him in a hold successfully, as you said, that could turn the tide. And once again, like I said, I think one or both of the aces in the hole hits Gaolang in this fight. I don't think they would set that up saying he's got some trump cards. We, the readers, don't even know what they are that will maybe work against Gaolang. And I think Gaolang goes into fight damage because there's no way they're going to put healthy 100% beat Justin Gaolang up against a very damaged Agito or Roland, because that's just going to be unfair. The final fight's going to have them at relatively equal damage of some description. So I do think Justin gets off one of his moves and it does heavy damage. As you said, some opening, some mistake by Gaolang has got to happen in this fight. I'm just curious on when and where, you know, like, how is it going to happen? You know, it's kind of, it's pretty exciting actually.
Yeah, now let me turn around and be a hypocrite and say I don't think Gaolang is going to lose, because I'm worried about the outrage of Gaolang losing. Because I think it's clear that even though people would probably want Justin to perform well, they don't want Justin to win against Gaolang. I don't think. I have not met a single person I have not seen. Actually, I have seen a few people that have bet on Justin, but I've seen way more people say that it would be bad for Justin to win this fight. Because,
but are they betting on Justin as sort of a dark horse, like throwing all their money up against the Patriots sort of idea in the Super Bowl? Or like on a whim? Or are they doing it because they actually want Justin to win because they don't want Gaolang to win? You know what I mean? Like, who's been, you know what I mean? So it's, I think it's one of those, because once again, I like Justin, but I think narratively speaking, and once again, we have the potential for an Agito versus Gaolang rematch. One of the best fights in the original series. And we finally get a rematch years and years later. I really, like, I know that Sandra likes to break up the narrative and he doesn't like MC power-ups and he sort of tries to go away from the tropes and shit. But my God, that would be a finals versus Agito and Gaolang once again. They set it up in fight one. So I'm just saying, like, yeah, it would be really weird for Justin to go to the finals at this point.
Yeah, I've seen it as a combination of people, because like ever since he won against Sakigake, because again, I think Justin's win against Sakigake really did catch a lot of people off guard, because even when I said Sakigake is going to lose, people didn't believe me, then it happened. But I think because of that, Justin has a little bit more momentum with a few people, where there are people who just don't like Gaolang, and then there are people who just like to bet on people that, you know, people look down on.
So the underdogs.
They're contrarians in that way.
If once again, I believe all my live streams when I first got into Kengan are still on there. When the tournament started, I did a bracket and I did betting on each round. And I bet the whole round, I would read all the chapters, blah, blah, blah. And as I said, I had like a 91-93% success rate. And I bet on quite a few underdogs. I was like, this guy has been set up as the, you know, this, that, and then the other thing. And I kept betting. And stupidly enough, I did bet against Kuroki once. It's kind of stupid for doing that. But anyways, it was either Setsuna or Agito. I bet against him for one of those two fights. Because I thought, narratively speaking, you know, Setsuna, like, Agito and Oma have to fight, and Setsuna and Oma have to fight, and this and that person have to fight. Like I was going down the MC, you know, shonen tropes, like, oh, the rivals have to fight, and the main bad guy needs to be beaten by the main character, and all this stuff, and I was right, I was wrong many times. I still had a great success rate, but I was wrong many times. So I think that some people are still hoping for that in a sense, to a degree that Sandro's can still, and I think that's why Ashura was so successful. I think people are just hoping in this tournament. And I think this tournament's too small. I think people should expect this more from cat number two, but to get these crazy upsets. Guys that shouldn't win, win. You know what I mean? I don't think we should be expecting that in this tournament or the Berserker Bowl. I think we should be expecting that in the, in the bigger tournaments, you know, expect the unexpected stuff. So maybe that's the whole dark horse thing. Though you could argue Rijito was a dark horse sort of in the Berserker Bowl, you know, so, and he won it. So I don't know.
Yeah, I guess it is what it is there. Let's go into former king versus current king. Agito versus Lolong. Who do you got? This one's going to be a very interesting one.
This is going to be right down to the wire. We're going to beat the absolute shit out of each other. And I mean the absolute shit out of each other. Nobody has advantage here. No matter how much Roland has improved, no matter how much Agito has improved, they've both improved. And I'm going to say Agito to win only because Gao Lang versus Agito is the match we've all been waiting for. One of the hardest panels still is Gao Lang coming into that fight with flames coming out against Agito. Like, that was the panel, you know, for so long. And that's the man who lost. But everyone's like, nah. Fucking hell, Gao Lang. That's what sold so many people on the man. And I'm just thinking, there's no way. Why would Sandra, why would you as a writer set this up with the potential of having one of your best fights ever? We have the rematch set up beautifully, and now we're not going to let it happen? Like, even if, let's say Roland wins against Augie, it could happen. In any other circumstance, if this was the finals, let's remove the narrative that Gao Lang, like, let's say it's Agito versus Roland in the final. It could go either way, once again, with no narrative, you know, consequence. I just am unsure whether we're going to see, I mean, yes, Agito just won against Julius, but he also lost against, is he really going to lose against both kings of Purgatory, saying that, oh, the Kangen Association is weaker than Purgatory? That Purgatory was always stronger than Kangen? You know, like, because that's sort of what that shows. Because the Emperor of the Kangen matches for years was Agito. And this is all that would tell us is that at the end of the day, he fought against anybody, any of the main matches of Purgatory, he would have lost. So I just don't see it. I see him giving him a very difficult fight. It's going to be an awesome fight. I hope it lasts for, you know, 9 chapters. I hope this fight is long as shit. I want it to be 2 months worth of chapters of this fight. But
I don't think it's going to be 2 chapters. I think we're looking at, like, because Sandrovic makes his fights a bit shorter. I'm guessing I know. 5 most.
I'm hoping for 9. I'll settle for 7. But any shorter than 7 chapters is doing disservice to an Agito Roland fight, in my opinion. But we will wait and see. I do want the fight to be long. I want the fight to be epic. I want the choreograph. I want the art. I want everything poured into this fight, if nothing else. I want everything poured into this and the finals. I don't care if the Justin Gao Lang fight that we're currently on has the best art or the choreography. If Sandro and Daro and everybody is working really, really hard to make the next 2 fights Ashura level. You know, if they're working hard to make those fights really good, then I'm good with it. But yeah, I mean, Gao Lang versus Lolong is also a good matchup. That's a fun matchup that I never knew I wanted, but I kind of am curious to see how it would go down. But I just think it's too storybook perfect and, you know, to not have Agito win his fight and go up against Gao Lang for a second time, you know? So, and in universe, as I said, they acknowledged it at the end of the fight. He didn't acknowledge Dorota. He just walked right over to the ringside, looked at Agito and said, "I'm coming for you." And I'm just like, all right, I'll be there. Let's do this. You know, it's just such a match made in heaven for me. But what do you think? You think Lolong or Agito?
I am a Lolong stan, okay? So I am backing Lolong all the way. Now, putting agendas aside, I would say, I don't think we're going to get the rematch between Agito versus, let's say, Gao Lang. I just don't think it's going to happen because it's happened before. Because, like, we already had, like, a rematch potential with Jurata, although that was still in Kengan Omega, right? I get that.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I just don't
see. And a little soon. It literally had just happened, right? Yeah, the fight had just happened, so.
Yeah, so that's one of the reasons. Another one I would say is that I still think someone like Lolong has a better future in comparison to someone like Agito. And this is going to be a hot take. I think Agito represents, let's say, the older era of the Kengan matches. Don't get me wrong, like, he's evolved as a fighter, he's grown as a character, but he's no longer the king of the Kengan matches. That's something I would like to point out just straight up first. He isn't the king anymore. And yeah, it's that thing where it's like, look, it seems like it would make more thematic sense that someone who is a current king, someone like Lo Long, who has, I would argue, more potential to fight someone like Kuroki in the future, because they still have that match, because it was sort of set up that Lo Long and Kuroki are going to have another match eventually based off of Lo Long's flashback. I think we're going to get that eventually, and that we need build up like this for someone like Lo Long. So I'm looking at it from that perspective of like which characters have, you know, more potential in the story going forward. Cause like Akito has his tie-ins to Nico, we know that. Like he's gonna be dealing with that, and he's probably gonna be fighting, you know, in the Annihilation Tournament as well. He's going to be participating in that. Gao Lang, really there's nothing. That's why I sort of doubt that he will win this tournament. Although there could be other plot points for him. But you have Lo Long, who has tie-ins with Kuroki, kind of like Agito as well, but also is tied into the whole worm plot. So he has this worm plot stuff going on with him, and it's like he has a better standing in the story as well. Because like literally recently Agito lost to Jirata. So I would say those are my reasons as to why I am backing Lo Long rather than, let's say, Agito. Now, how do I think the fight itself will go? I do expect a high diff, but I am worried for Agito here. Because if Lo Long has devastating moves up his sleeve and Agito can't deal with them, this match might end quicker and might be the biggest upset ever. Just straight up ever. But Agito could also have new stuff in his bag as well. So yeah, high diff, I say Lo Long is gonna win. But yeah, those are my thoughts on that fight. It has a lot to carry on its shoulders, in my opinion, because it is the biggest fight in this tournament. Like it is, I would argue it is the most important fight in this tournament. Like this tournament, the rankings for this tournament depend on this fight, in my opinion. But yeah.
So it sounds like what we have is I have Gao Lang mid diff victory, and I have Agito high diff victory. You have Gao Lang mid to high diff victory, and Lo Long high diff victory.
Yeah,
do I have that all right?
Yeah. I would say it's a right.
Well, that's a pretty good summary. Then you know it's not bad though. It's not bad. We'll see who's right by the end of round two, right?
Yeah, we'll see. I guess the only other thing that's interesting, because like I have been trying to think for a while, like because the whole point of this is to get a fighter who is possibly as strong as like let's say the connector, which he probably won't be, but we're expecting the fighter who wins this tournament to be, you know, at least slightly stronger than the current top tiers, right? Like they're gonna be one of the fighters that are gonna be probably gonna be taking the most seriously, other than like let's say characters like Kuroki and Oma that are basically like they don't even need this tournament to establish how much we can take them seriously.
But even that is just ridiculous, because at the end of the day, it's like even if they get a Rehito, oh my god, I finally understand the third part of mastery, blah blah blah, in the middle of a fight, whatever, it's no one's going to automatically, like Agito or Roland or Gal, it's not all of a sudden gonna go, I now have principles in the finals. You know what I mean? No, that's not going to happen. So what they're doing is very desperate. It's very desperate. I don't think anybody's going to discover principles at the end of this fight. I mean, or the end of this tournament. As you said, maybe, but I just don't see it, because it would feel very unearned. Because nobody fought a gauntlet. They fought two fights. You know what I mean? It's not the Annihilation Tournament. It's not like Gao Lang had to fight eight people. Agito had to fight eight top tiers. They fought a couple of matches against each other, and boom, all of a sudden we understand principles. Like, that feels very unearned, in my opinion. So I don't think that that's going to happen. I really don't. I think they're just hoping for the best by pitting their best fighters up against each other, and maybe they improve enough that they can give them pause, maybe? Like, I don't know. I don't know what they're expecting from this, because I don't expect any of these characters to be able to fight Shen by the end of the tournament. So, well, maybe that's just being pessimistic, but I don't know.
Yeah, I expect something. It might not be fighting Shen, but I expect, like, a breakthrough of some sort.
Oh, sure. Improvement, 100%, but nothing what they want, like what, you know, the Anti-Worm Alliance and the companies and stuff want, not what the Kangen Association wants. Like, no one's, like, they've all improved. We've already seen it. Agito's improved since his fight with Jiroda. Julius improved in his fight against Agito. Gao Lang just improved against his fight in Jiroda. We've already seen improvements in this tournament. Improvements are 100% going to happen. And I expect both Agito and Roland in their fight to improve by fighting each other. They will, whoever wins, it won't matter. It will matter, but they're both going to improve by fighting each other to the absolute brink. They are going to improve. It might be a small improvement, a mid-level improvement, a high improvement. They're going to improve. And once again, it seemed like Shen was sort of saying that Kuroki was getting there, but not quite there. He was hiding something, and he said, you're only at pre-initiative. We assume that that means that pre-initiative eventually evolves into principles. Now, if that gap could be closed in this tournament, maybe, and we start seeing guys like Gao Lang and Agito maybe almost get right to the base, right to the bottom of the hill, and look up and say, hey, I see where principles is. It's not up in the clouds anymore. Like, I'm at a mastery of pre-initiative where there it is. I see where principles is. I can get there. You know, maybe we see something like that. I'd be okay with that. But yeah, because it seems like the moment you get principles, once again, we don't know enough about it quite yet, but like if it sort of seems like principles almost like Ultra Instinct from Dragon Ball, that once you get principles, there's no mastering principles. You have principle, and principles is the mastery. So I just don't think anybody's going to gain it in this tournament, but maybe they get a foothold into figuring it out. You know, seems like Kuroki's almost there. So, and he's trying to teach Oma how. So,
well, it would seem like Oma would telling him, you know, what Shen showed him when he basically gave him those pointers,
which he probably already did, because yeah, we saw them training after that. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But remember that Shen also said that guy Kuroki Gensai, yeah, he's pretty close to what I'm after. And neither one of them went all out. Now, you know, we've already discussed that before, but I just think that maybe the idea that the S tiers are going to jump up into, I guess, double S tier soon. You know, we're going to have Ryan, Oma, Agito, Roland. They're all going to improve massively by the end of this year sort of idea. You know, people in the tournament, people outside of the tournament, whatever. Everyone's going to slowly improve and start to get a foothold into whatever Shen's realm of principles is. I think we'll go that direction, sure. But do you think somebody's actually going to figure out principles by the end of this tournament?
I'm not too sure about that. It would seem like it would take a pretty bizarre set of events for that to happen. Because, like, unless someone outright tells you how this thing works, and even then you might not get it, you would need to experience something bizarre. So, like, kind of like how Ryan was using the Nodachi to learn principles. You know, something like that. Something where it's like, understanding what you're doing and how it works is going to be very difficult. I don't know if these will be the right set of conditions for that to happen, but it could be depending.
But we also know that Shen didn't teach Kuroki anything, and Kuroki was nearly there already. So I think it's also one of those things that principles at the end of the day, it's just the ultimate form of mastery of martial arts. In the long and short of it, that's what principles means. It means you are literally, this is the peak. This is the actual ceiling. You thought pre-initiative was the ceiling. You thought that mastering your own style was the ceiling. That's not the ceiling. The ceiling is full mastery, like Zen, like full on. And I think that's what, in a very simplistic way, that's all principles is. It's knowing, as you said, it's knowing the flow of energy and stuff. But we've seen that. Nico style users know that already. Agito, Oma, all these guys have already seen that. We saw that in very early chapters. Ulma being able to stop brute force with a fingertip and shit like that. And we've seen it from Hatsumi with his Aikido. He's able to flip dudes that weigh 300, 400 pounds with a flick of his wrist. Like, understanding the flow of power isn't all that Principles is about. You know, we've seen it. That's what we've seen it utilized as. But I think it's just more simplistic than that. It's just a simple mastery of your body, mastery of your mind, and mastery of all, not all martial arts styles, but just your own style and being able to move your body to its utmost. Like when he was showing Ulma, you know, like just move 2 millimeters here, go down here a little bit, boom. See, now you're in the perfect stance. That's the perfect way to do it, you know, slight adjustments and stuff. And I think that's all Principles is knowing the absolute perfect way to launch an attack, a counter, a defense, whatever.
Yeah, I think that last I would lean towards that because what was interesting is that I also think of it as a sort of optimization of the fighting process of sorts. Because like, there are people who can use these ideas, but they seem to be able to do very specific things. They can't. They're not as flexible as Shen Wulong is, where it's like, it almost seems like he can do anything with just that. Like, when he can, like, it's very interesting that he can literally knock people out with just by tapping them. Like what he did with Misasa, right. And of course, when he was getting jumped.
Right. Because he knows the acupuncture, he knows all the areas, he's got all the knowledge, sure, but he also knows exactly where to strike, when, and how, right? Like,
yeah, it's that optimization. It's like, oh, okay.
Yep.
It could be that you might have someone who is like that in the tournament who ends up getting to that level where it's like, because that's really what Shen Wulong told Ulma to do. He was like, look, you've already reached how much power you're going to have in your, you know, physically, and you already like sort of mastered the Nikko style as well. You just need to optimize, you know, what you already can do, and you will grow by leaps and bounds, right?
Given that, I think Gao Lang is closest than anybody in this tournament by doing that. And he showcased that because he doesn't use pre-initiative. He is literally the technical fighter. He's optimizing what he knows at his best. He knows his body, he knows his style, he knows multiple styles, but he knows he doesn't rely on pre-initiative. He doesn't rely on gimmicks. He doesn't rely on other things. He is fully invested. He's a master of his own style, similar in the way of Kuroki is, but I would argue that he's almost getting to that level of optimization. You put it perfectly by saying optimization. It's a perfect word for it. And that is exactly, I think, that Gao Lang optimizes his moves, and we saw it in the Dorota fight, to their perfect degree. Whether he takes damage or not, as we saw, he knew he was waiting for the counter, so he was going to counter the counter. It's like, I know I'm going to take a hit, but I'm going to counter it and stuff, and that's the way to win and stuff. He knows how to optimize his moves and read ahead without pre-initiative, you know, and it's just like, yeah, so that's perfect word choice.
Yeah. But yeah, that's it. We have been talking for a while, man. I think we might be 2 hours or three, actually. Who knows? But
holy crap, yeah.
Yeah. But hey, any last words you have for this, I guess? Because I think we've already talked about nigh on everything.
Yeah, we covered everything, I think. I just want to say thank you very much once again for inviting me on. You know, I like doing these collabs with you, and I hope to do another one when the tournament's finished in the future. That'd be great. Everyone, subscribe to Dio. Subscribe to me, too. I do Kengan shit, too. But yeah, no, it's been a pleasure. It's been a great time, and I hope to be back on this channel more sooner rather than later. So, yeah.
Yeah, I think those are some great closing words. Okay, you can talk about anything at this point.
All right, so let me tell you about the birds and the bees. Now, when a mommy and a daddy love each other very much.
You can improvise so well. I had no idea what you were going to say. I was like, wow, I'm putting Creep on the spot with this one.
No, see, that's what you got to do. You see, if that one takes, you got to put that at the very end of the video as a blooper. We were testing the audio, and here's what Creeper came up with.
All right, yeah. All right. Let's see. Hope. Hopefully that gets recorded.
Test that one. Test that one, yeah.